in order for DB Wise and David Benioff to get this project 11 to 12 years ago,
they had to guess the ending.
Asked a very simple question: who do you think is going to end up on throne?
Mm.
And they answered this. So 12 years later, we saw this is what George has in his brain that he's going to write in his book eventually in the Dream of Spring. This ending, which is kind of ironic because it's called Game of Thrones, and in the last episode, there's no more throne.
It's now called Game of.
That's Game of Wheelchairs now. From now on, like if there was an episode 9, it'd be Game of Wheelchairs. My favorite is like, Uncle, sit down.
They got school already, basically.
Shut him up.
Yes. And then everybody was like, oh.
It even turned worse when his sword hit the pillar. And yeah.
Like, now you have a sellsword, a pirate, a female knight, and a dwarf.
Ruling the country.
A coward.
Yeah.
I like that council. It's just fucking awesome.
It's awesome.
Representation, huh?
Hello and welcome to the very final episode of our Game of Thrones Season 8 recap. So guys, with the way it ended, did you guys love it? Or did you guys hate it?
7 out of 10. It's a bittersweet ending for me. Better writing overall. I think it's a deserved ending. I feel it's made for people who watched the show since Episode 1, Season 1. Probably not the happiest ending for everyone, but it ticks more boxes than leaving them empty.
Okay. Right, how about you, Nick?
I'm very conflicted about it. Okay, this is the ranting fanboy side of it. Like, we were promised so much shit over 8 seasons, and we didn't get any of that shit. The prince that was promised, Azor Ahai, the Valokar or whatever shit, none of it means anything. The Children of the Forest, the Night King, none of it means anything.
Quoting Melisandre, prophecies are funny things.
None of it. Like, these are all red herrings. For the past 8 seasons, we've just been fed red herrings.
What do you think about the outcome? I mean, okay, I agree where you're coming from as well.
It feels a bit weird having Bran on board.
It could have been better.
Yeah.
I just felt it could have been pushed better in... I don't mind Bran being up there. It's just that...
I feel that he's also more of a puppet ruler in a
because
sense.
Because he doesn't want it. Like, yeah. Even to that point, he said, like, I don't want it.
Yeah. So, I guess, Tyrion ends up becoming the hand
then again,
to Bran.
Then
to
again.
Bran.
He immediately appoints Tyrion to be his Hand of the King.
Because he doesn't want to do the work.
And then when Tyrion said, I don't want to be Hand of the King, he said, I don't want to be king. So if you think about it, he knows that the only way to get Tyrion to run the kingdom
is for him to be king.
Exactly.
So I guess your theory kind of worked out in the end when Tyrion gets the throne.
So even though he's not sitting on the throne, he is the one that's calling the shots.
I mean, he can't sit on the throne because the throne was burnt.
Yeah.
Okay, so he's like a puppet king.
Yeah, because he knows the best person to run it is Tyrion.
Yeah.
At the end of... Because Tyrion said, people don't want me to be there because...
He's the most democratic of them all. Once you say it like that, I'm actually okay with it.
Now you see, so Bran has always been playing the game. The most powerful person, there's no more throne, but the one that's sitting on the throne is Tyrion.
So we got the ending we wanted. So this is a double bluff from D&D.
Exactly. At the end of the day, it was a double bluff when he said, you don't want to be Hand of the King? I don't want to be king. So he just played it back to Tyrion. So Tyrion said, okay, if I want you to be king, then I have to accept the role.
I mean, the only way to make that seem more obvious is if Bran did a nudge, wink, wink, like...
Yeah.
Like that.
I think we need that because some of the fandom are still bitching like...
No.
And everyone saw it.
Look, it's Game of Thrones. People should be smarter than that.
No.
They can pick up on that.
No. People say Bran is the king. Yeah, he's... Like, maybe the word puppet king is not the best word to use.
Actually, I'm calling it
proxy,
for what it is.
Maybe the proxy.
I'm calling it for what it is.
Proxy king. So...
I'm not saying Bran is useless, obviously not, because he can still track things, do the wilding, weirding thing.
But Tyrion's calling
the shots. That just changes everything. So that means we got a despot out of the way, Dany. Mm. We got a weak hero, that just wants to be a hero out of the way as well, sent up to the north, Jon.
Yeah.
And then the person that just wants to be an adventurer continues adventuring. Mm. Like, what's west of Westeros? I don't know. The maps.
Let's go find out.
So Arya goes there.
Yeah.
And, Sansa gets her wish.
Yeah,
she gets freedom for the North. The North is now... There's only 6 kingdoms now.
Yeah.
It's not 7 kingdoms.
Yeah, so during that council bit in the third act, basically Sansa was the only one who said, nope, I'm not going to be under Bran, but I love Bran and all, but I'm going to rule the North as my own kingdom.
I bet you the rest were like, why the fuck was it not last to say I?
Yeah.
Everybody was like, I. Yeah. And then she went like... Wait a minute.
I think I'll just rule this kingdom on my own,
I bet Yara was like, I could have done that. Mm.
Makes sense for Sansa, after her character arc and all that, to get that ending she deserves to rule over her own kingdom, being the strong woman she is.
And besides Bran, I like her arc the best.
Yeah.
In all 8 seasons. Mm-hmm. In the first 4, I really hated her because I felt like she was spineless.
No, she's supposed to be spineless in order to get a backbone later on.
I love Joffrey. And then when she went through the Bolton shit and the Littlefinger shit, that just gave her a spine and a resolve. She earned. Queen in the North, she earned that.
And she learned the from everyone. She learned from really, really bad kings.
From Boltons,
from Lanning, from double Lannisters.
Lannisters.
She learned about the whole politicking from the Tyrells.
Oh yeah.
She learned from Peter Baelish.
What about that?
I really like the idea that you said that Tyrion is now actually the one in control. That's what I wanted all along.
Because the
moment,
the meeting haven't even started and Bran's like, okay, I'll go look for the dragon.
Yeah.
It's good to see all those like second tier non-nobles actually sitting in the council.
Yes.
I'm happy
like
for
Bron.
That.
I, that's why I felt that council was a fresh change.
A progressive council.
A progressive council. Now you have a sellsword, a pirate, a female knight, and a dwarf.
Ruling the country.
And a coward.
Yeah.
I like that council. It's just fucking awesome.
It's awesome.
Representation,
Upward
mobility is now a thing in Westeros.
It's funny that Bran's asking for Master of Whisperers when, dude, You're like China, dude. You know everything.
Yeah, you're like super. You're the Chinese satellite.
The thing with Bran is some people online are saying like, oh, Bran's such a bastard for like he knew for like the past 3 seasons that he was gonna be king. The thing is, Bran doesn't see. He sees divergent timelines. He doesn't see a full.
He doesn't know that full
prime,
path. It's like bits here and there.
That's a good argument. But what if he knew what needs to be done to get Tyrion to run the kingdom?
I mean, he did say to Jon Snow, you were there when you needed to be.
His final play is Tyrion. Tyrion is his Tony Stark snap. Not the best outcome for everyone, but that's the best for the whole kingdom.
Yeah, you need a guy like Tyrion to run the country. And
he's
what better way?
He's not running the country. He's not running the kingdom. Yeah. This guy is.
Yeah.
So, I'm happy.
Yeah.
I thought that was a good Game of Thrones ending. Not necessarily the good ending.
Which a lot of people doesn't realize yet. A lot of people are still bitching about Bran.
But if you look at it from that perspective.
Yeah, it never was about Bran in the end.
I thought the magic line has always been. I don't want to be king.
It's quite surprising because to me, it's from out of the left field. And I was against that decision. Like driving here, I was like bitching. Oh, this is so fucking stupid, man. He doesn't even want the fucking thing. And then the aha moment was when you said it like, but he doesn't want to be king.
Yeah.
And now like the guy that I really want to be king anyway, which is Tyrion, he's fucking king.
He actually is.
By proxy.
By proxy, that's the only way he can get it to happen.
That suddenly he just aha! Like, oh my god, fucking brilliant. Fucking brilliant, like George. Fucking brilliant.
Good stuff.
For people to say, oh, that's a bad ending. I don't think. You just missed the point.
You just
missed what they were talking.
It was never about Danny. It was never about John.
I kind of like this ending too. I mean, of course, it took quite a while to get there, but we're finally at the end. And I do believe, I mean, maybe it's just a theory on my side where I believe David and DB intended to create the episode like this. But the point to actually get from episode 1 to this, the stuff that happens in the middle, could use a little bit more work, per se.
Yeah.
But I felt that this ending itself was really good. Well done.
It's a satisfactory ending.
Well, satisfactory.
Well, if you look at season 8 as a whole, if you want
it needs work in the middle.
Not really. If you want to start painting Dany as a corrupt or despot leader, it kind of makes sense that in Battle of Winterfell, she just wasted her Dothraki and Anzali. Because she's not meant to be a good leader that you eventually want to see on the throne.
Yeah.
You know?
I think the only
even Jon, like as a military leader, he was crap, so he's not worthy of the
throne. we're so bitter about the fact that they sent the cavalry out first.
I just think they built Dany too much that
they had to break her down like throughout this whole
really quick. Yeah. So she can't do no wrong that when there's a flip, people can't accept it.
So I think the season as a whole.
They had to nerf her this season.
They do. Yeah. This season as a whole, definitely, it's suffering from that whole like, we need to wrap this up, itis. It's a disease that happens in most TV shows.
Yeah.
I think this episode needs an extra scene where, you know, Sam talks to a bunch of other philosophers or maybe to Davos, like, about certain prophecies. Oh, this actually. And then just some lines from Sam saying it didn't work out in the end.
I would live if, like, Old Town actually has an Area 51, is it?
Oh.
So, like the book about Azor Ahai, he just goes and put it in, like, and then he walks away, he closes the crypt, it's like Area 51.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, the myth.
It's like, in the
that
end,
could
yeah.
have happened in Westeros, but it didn't happen.
As a red haired woman once told me, prophecies are a funny thing.
Yeah.
And it puts the stuff in there.
That would have been
it
nice.
Needs that one scene.
Yeah,
maybe that one scene.
Yeah.
just to shut everyone up, just to make sure that there's some closure in this bit, you know.
Prophecies. Those are not facts.
Yeah. It's prophecies, never facts.
If it kind of happened, then it happens. But doesn't mean that they're telling the truth.
I think with that, we can end this episode. Yeah, I think we're pretty much happy with what's going
on. 7 out of 10.
Good stuff from all of us. So anyway, yeah, do follow us. Follow Nick at buzzpop.tv. Follow us at thekkp.com. And this has been us signing out. So see ya.